bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast of the Lord, and humble shall hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Let's pray together. God, our Father, we thank you, O God, for another awesome day, O God, a day in which we can rejoice and praise your name, O God. Master God, we ask that you would bless this worship experience, O God. We pray, O God, that those that are out in the net, that they may receive your presence and your power, O God. And Master, we pray that you would bless these men as they minister to us in the form of song, O God. That we pray that all that we do, let it bring glory and honor to your name. We ask this, Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven in tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. Amen. The grass withered and the flower faded, but the word of our God shall stand forever.
All right.
This Sunday is celebrated in Christian corridors as Pentecost. It is designated as 50 days after the time of Jesus' resurrection. And today, we want to celebrate Pentecost. I believe that there is so much that is going on in our lives and in our communities today that needs to be dealt with. But I believe that it's important that the church look at the power of Pentecost, because I want to argue that there's a message that only Pentecost can give to you and I today. I want to suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, that in that early day, the day of the early church, Jesus, even after he was preparing to ascend, he reminds his disciples to go ye into all the world to preach and teach and baptize in the name of the Father. The Bible says he reminds them that whatsoever I commanded you, that you do. And he says, lo, I'll be with you. But he also reminds his disciples that he must go away. And he says unto them to dwell in Jerusalem. He says, I want you to remain there until the power of the Holy Spirit comes. And he declares, and then you shall become witnesses. And I want to suggest, my brothers and sisters, the Bible says that they had been in a waiting pattern, waiting for what Jesus had declared for. He declared in John 14 that he will send the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit will be our comforter, the Holy Spirit will be our God. And I just want to celebrate the Holy Spirit this morning, because without the Holy Ghost, y'all, I couldn't stand before you today. But thanks be to God for his Holy Spirit. The Bible says that something miraculous happened this day as all of the saints were gathered together. There were some from this nation and some from that nation. And in the text, it lists examples of nations that are gathered around, different tongues and different ethnicities, but they all gathered together. And I want to suggest, my brothers and sisters, that the Bible helps us is about how Pentecost truly comes. And I want to suggest, y'all, that first of all, there is a prerequisite. The Bible says that on that day, it says that when the day of Pentecost was fully come. Oh, y'all, I wish I had time to deal with this like I want to. But the text alludes to the fact that Pentecost had happened before, that there were other times in which Pentecost was celebrated. Matter of fact, in the Jewish community, Pentecost would often surround the Jews, that they would gather together. This is according to the Old Testament. And they would, individuals would bring grains of corn and grounds of flour, and they would add oil and leaves and make leavened bread. And they would take two loaves and they would place it as a sacrifice. And they would have a goat that would be burned for the sin offering, and two other offerings would be made for the peace of mankind. And they would do this at Pentecost as a sacrifice for the people that had gathered together. But the Bible says that on this day, Pentecost had fully come. Unlike any other time before, there was no need for any burnt offerings anymore, because Jesus Christ was the perfect Lamb of God. And when he hung, bled, and died on Calvary, he took care of our sin debt, both for that was behind us, that we are experiencing now, and that we might have to deal with in the future. I want to suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, that Jesus settled it at a cross called Calvary. He paid it once and for all, and not just for John Johnson, but to all of them that were called upon the name of Jesus. I would suggest to you, my brothers and sisters,
He says that it had fully become, it had fully come. And I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, the other prerequisite here is the Bible says they were all on one accord. I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, the Bible says they came from many nations. And by fact, if you read the first chapter there, it suggests that there were some 120 of them gathered together. And listen, it's awesome, y'all, when folk from other nations gather together, and they don't, their experience may not be my experience, but we all have one thing in common, that I've been with Jesus. Listen, the text says that some of us, y'all, as we gather in different places, some of us that will be listening to this broadcast, we have different experiences. But listen, one thing that attracts us is that we have a relationship with Jesus Christ. The Bible says they were connected together. They were on one accord. Now, what all of my brothers and sisters, I would suggest y'all, on that day, y'all, they went up at 120 individuals, but they came down as one body in Christ Jesus. I would argue something powerful, something mighty happened, but it happened because they were all together. And I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, the church would be different, y'all, if we all came together on one accord. We may not always look alike. We may not always agree on everything, but oh, if we agree on the power of Jesus Christ, if we agree that he hung, bled, and died, and rose the third day morning, y'all, if we would agree as a body of baptized believers, I heard the word declare that if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. I will forgive their sins. I will heal their land. I want to suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, that something powerful happened because they were all on one accord. And can I help y'all this morning? In my own eyes, y'all, this morning, I see the virus being healed and counseled, not necessarily just because of the vaccine, but because of the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. If my people will come together and pray, y'all, we can turn the enemy astray. If my people will come and pray, listen, we won't have to burn no buildings down. Listen, we can lift up the name of Jesus, and at the name of Jesus, oh, help me somebody. I don't get me wrong, y'all. I think protest is good, but listen, you ought not, the Bible says, be ye angry, but sin not. You ought not cause a turmoil for the whole nation. Listen, I want to suggest, y'all, that this thing says that Pentecost happened because they were all on one accord. But listen, y'all, I would argue secondly, y'all, that Pentecost not only has a prerequisite, but listen, I want to argue at Pentecost there was a presence. And I want to suggest, y'all, the Bible says that the people were there. And I want to suggest, y'all, that those that had been in hiding had now come out, and they called up to the upper room. And the Bible says they were in one place, on one accord. And the Bible says, and suddenly something happened. Oh, I don't know about you, y'all. Have you ever been in a situation, listen, that you've been asking and you've been waiting God for, and you thought it was gonna come in this way, you thought it was gonna come, but all of a sudden, when you least expected, God showed up. I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, they were there not even knowing what they were waiting for, but then suddenly the presence of God showed up. I want to declare to you, my brothers and sisters, I don't care where I am, I'm always looking for the presence of God to show up. The Bible says he showed up that day, and the Bible says that he came through like that of a sound of a rushing wind. Listen, I don't know if you've ever experienced the whirlwinds of a hurricane or the whirlwinds of a tornado, the rushing and the power of the wind. You can't see it, but you can hear it. And I'm going to argue, my brothers and sisters, the Bible says the power of God descended upon that place in the upper room where they were gathered that day. And the Bible says that it descended. They heard something. The sound appeared unto them. But then the Bible says that they saw something. The Bible says it showed as coals of fire. The Bible says that it sat upon them. And I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, oftentimes in the New Testament, fire that the Holy Spirit is illustrated in the form of fire. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, Jeremiah even argued the point. He says it's just like what? That fire. Shut up, in my voice.
Yeah.
I want to thank God, my brothers and sisters, that every now and then, y'all, sometimes it happens on the outside, but all thanks be to God, every now and then something will happen on the inside of us. Listen, the Bible says that when it was fully come, that he allowed it to shine down upon them. The Bible says it, and there it shouted, it appeared unto them like that. Didn't necessarily say it was fire, but sometimes, y'all, what God does, it doesn't have a name for. So he has to show us something that we have appeal for. Paul says, I've been to the first, second, and third heaven, but I can't tell you what I saw because the language is too high for you to understand. Listen, I'm lying. He says, it's like fire. It's like the sound. And the Bible says, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. And the Bible says, and they began to speak in other tongues. I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, that was a prerequisite. That was the presence. The Bible says, at the presence, he filled them there with the Holy Spirit. He fulfilled what he said he was going to do. God always fulfills his promises, and whatever he declared, he will make do of what he said. On that day, the Bible says that he fulfilled his purpose, his promise in John 14, verses 8 and down 4. The Bible says that he promises the Holy Ghost that it will fill us, it will empower us, it will guide us, and he made it be so on that day. And listen, you know, I would argue, my brothers and sisters, there's so much division about what happened that day, and as it relates to the next part of this verse, for the Bible says, and they spake in other tongues. And I want to suggest to you, my brothers and sisters, I don't have time to go in deep with it, but I want to argue, my brothers and sisters, that this was not a glacier tongue. It was not something unknown. But in this context, everybody spoke in a tongue where the others understood what they were saying. If I can give you an example, y'all, if we had in our congregation people from Tokyo, people from Greek, people from Turkey, people from Australia, Germany, England, and all of us are gathered in here, and God does something, and God allows it to be so that we all can speak at the same time. And this, and all of us, we hear their language and understand their reading. Listen, I've seen this happen one time before, but like not necessarily in languages, but I'm serving in Turkey at the time, I'm serving in Germany at the time, and we had some people from Romania came over, and they were a communist country at that time, and they weren't allowed to have free and open worship experiences. They had to hide behind doors and have secret doors in secret places. But they came, some who had escaped came, and they worshiped with us on one particular Sunday. I was playing the piano at the time, and we were leading in Amazing Grace, and we began to sing, and one of the other brothers was there, had his guitar, and listen, couldn't even understand English, but he got up and he started playing along in Amazing Grace. And another lady had a violin, and she began to play. Listen, couldn't understand a word of English, but listen, the power of Amazing Grace reached far beyond that nationality. It reached far beyond that language barrier. It was something that we all had in common. We knew about the grace of God. I'm glad, my brothers and sisters. On that day, they all spake, and they spake in a way that others could hear, and only God could do a thing like this, y'all. And I want to suggest, y'all, God did this thing on purpose, y'all. He purposely allowed so because the gospel was to go forth, and it was not to go just in Jerusalem. It wasn't no longer just for the Jews, but it's for the Greeks and for the Greek and Roman community. And he says, they shall all go forth in my name. And he lifts all these places because he wants you to know that when you go forth in my name, I want you to go to Romania. I want you to go to Crete. I want you to go to all of these other places. and declare the gospel of Jesus Christ. Listen, y'all, my time is running out, but I want to argue, y'all. That's what Pentecost was all about. It was filling us so that we may be witnesses of him. He offered both first in Jerusalem, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. Now, with all of my brothers and sisters, we lose the effectiveness of Pentecost when we think it's just speaking in tongues. I would argue it's much more than that, y'all. He gives us power that we may become witnesses of his. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, that not only is there a prerequisite, not only is his presence there, not only is his promise fulfilled, but I would argue, my brothers and sisters, he gives us power.
Yes. Listen,
my brothers and sisters, he says that I will invoke you with power so that you may go forth. And I want to argue, y'all, we can't do none of this by ourselves.
That's right.
They can't sing just by themselves. I don't care how good your voice is, but listen, when you mix it with the power of the Holy Spirit, y'all, it gives an unction that you can't do all by yourself. But I would argue, I don't care how good you look, I don't care how fine you think you are, until the Holy Ghost have come upon you. And I would argue, Baptist folk ought not be afraid of the Holy Ghost, because it's not to a denomination, it's to a people of God. And I would argue, we all need the power of the Holy Ghost, because I don't care how good we think we are. Listen, we'll never be as good as God has created us to be without his Holy Spirit. Listen, I got to end, y'all, but I'm going to just tell you my experience as a young fellow. My grandmother had an old car in her yard, and my uncle had given it to her, and he wanted her to learn how to drive. My grandma was over 60 at that time, and matter of fact, she had already retired, and he bought her that car that she would drive, and my grandmother drove that car maybe once or twice and parked it in the driveway. And so finally, my uncle took the battery loose and didn't want the battery to run down. And before long, my sister and I, we growing up, we learned to play in that car. As a matter of fact, y'all, we learned to drive in that car. Listen, we were pretend driving, y'all. And we played around with that car. We turned the steering wheel in that car. And listen, it was clean. It was a nice looking car. And we thought we were going somewhere in our sanctified imagination.
Okay.
We had places that we were going and places we were going to do. But y'all, I promise you, I don't care how well of a driver we thought we were, as long as the battery wasn't looped up, we couldn't go nowhere. Oh, one day, my uncle put a battery in that car. And he said, son, nephew, I want you to drive that car. And the same way I used to drive, now I can put my foot on the pedal. Now I can put power in the car. And I can go wherever I want to go. I want to argue, my brothers and sisters. When I was young, I was in a standstill position. But now the car got power. I can go. Listen, some of us, we were used to being fed like milk or babes. But God has given us the power of the Holy Spirit. And we ought to be on the feet of the Word, sharing the Word of God, that the world may come to know Jesus.
Yes.
The Lord, my brothers and sisters, he's given the power, not for you to blow the horn as to how good of a Christian you are, but that you may share the love of Jesus Christ. And I declare to you, my brothers and sisters, wherever you are, I declare that there's nothing in this world that God has not seen before among his children. And I would argue, y'all, that if you would dare surrender your life to him, listen, he hung and bled on the cross of Calvary for your sins and my sins. And the Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died. Thanks be to God, for he died for the remission of our sin. He paid our sin debt. But he says, but whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. You're here today and you've never trusted him as your Lord and your Savior. As you're listening on this broadcast, I would argue, my brothers and sisters, I invite you to trust him. Believe him. Believe that he hung, bled, and died for your sins, but that God raised him from the dead on the third day morning. And listen, y'all, and the Bible says he's now seated at the right hand of God. Why is that important, y'all? Because he pleads on your behalf and my behalf to the Father. And I would argue, my brothers and sisters, I want to suggest that he will come
and make your life brand new. Bible says he stands at the door and he knocks at the door of your heart, but he won't force himself in. The Bible says he'll come in. This is one great thing of this text. The Bible says, after the mighty wind and after the fire, the Bible says he doesn't set them on fire. The Bible says he rests upon them. Oh, that's so powerful. Y'all, that God didn't have to bog down. God didn't have to beat you up. He didn't have to beat you down. The Bible says he'll come and rest upon you. Listen, today, if you trust him, allow him to rest his presence. Rest his power upon you. Allow his anointing, his unction to overtake you, and watch him make your life brand new. God, our Father, we come in Jesus' name. We love you. We thank you. We praise you for whom all of our blessings for. Forgive us when we fail you. Come short of your blessing. Oh God, minister, oh God, to us in this time of invitation. And we'll seek to draw men and women, boys and girls unto you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.